It's good because I have a choice of who I want to be.
Many choices.
So welcome to everybody.
You're the right guy. No, that's him. That's it. We can sleep.
Welcome to everybody. It's a real pleasure to have you here. Thanks to those who accepted our invitation to contribute to the workshop. And of course, thanks to all of those who have decided to attend, both in presence as well as online. Thank you, of course, to Stefano Fantoni, to Nicola Casagli, for leading this initiative of TLQS, which I'm sure will give us a number of fruitful results, because I think it's an innovative idea to bring together different competencies to tackle this fundamental problem of making our economic activities more sustainable environmentally, socially, and economically by combining different approaches. And most importantly, as it has already been underlined, by taking a quantitative approach. Sustainability is a term that today is very commonly used, but oftentimes it's not used in the correct way. And oftentimes our choices are made without really considering what the impact is, but rather thinking that what we're doing is the most sustainable solution. And food is one of the areas where these misbeliefs are most common. The first misbelief that the consumers have is that food production is not very important from the point of view of its impact on the environment. All the statistics tell us the opposite. 34% of the greenhouse gas emissions are due to the food production process. So it's more than a third. And of that 34%, two-thirds are due to the primary production alone. So the process of agricultural production. Only one-third is due to whatever comes downstream of the agricultural production, the supply chain, the transformation, and so on and so forth. And for example, one of the most common beliefs that the consumer buys into is the zero kilometer strategy. And in transportation, when it comes to food production, weighs very little on the environmental impact. There is a very nice paper that was published a few years ago by a group of British economists who made a life cycle assessment of the environmental impact of a loaf of bread. From when we put the seeds of wheat into the field until when the loaf of bread gets on our table. And whatever is the measure of environmental impact that we use, two-thirds of the impact are due to just the production of the wheat seeds. So from when we put the seeds into the field until when we collect them. Transportation weighs for less than 5%. One factor alone weighs for 45%. And guess what is that factor? It's nitrogen fertilization. So nitrogen fertilization, when we consume a loaf of bread, is the most important factor in determining the environmental impact of that loaf of bread. And so if we want to really affect the environmental impact by decreasing it, we need to know what is the exact weight of each factor so that we can choose which factor to try to improve on. And of course, we will start with those that have the biggest weight. At the same time, we do not always make rational choices when it comes to food choices. And if it's a general truth that humans are usually not in favor of innovation of whatever type, and history teaches us that we have always been resilient to accepting innovations. This is even more true when it comes to food. When we make our food choices, and I, even though I consider myself a scientist, I admit that I also make choices based on these beliefs. I mean, the values that we go for are natural, old, small. When it comes to artificial, new, large, those are not the winning values. Those are the losing values. And we are not considering so much really what the environmental impact of what we buy is, but we're rather buying into these type of values. And the food transformation industry, I must admit, is also part of this problem, because their marketing strategies are trying to convince the consumer to buy not necessarily into what is most environmentally sustainable, but rather they're trying to convince him that they have to sort of be nostalgic of the good old times, when according to what they want to make us believe, everything was working better than it is working now. But for example, if we think about milk production, I mean, we all know that animal products are part of the big impact on the environment of food production. If we think about the production of a liter of milk, the environmental impact of the production of a liter of milk in Europe is 1/6 of what it is in Africa today. So despite the fact that we are so against intensive farming, the environmental impact of intensive farming is much smaller than the environmental impact of all traditional farming strategies that are still being used in Africa. And that puts that into another type of problem. I mean, if we look at what is expecting us, we know that the world population is increasing. The statistics tell us that we are soon going to be 10 billion. Now we are about 8 billion. It's not only increasing in number, it's also increasing in food needs. And that's thanks to the fact that there is a sustained economic development, especially in the poorer areas of the world. A lot of these demographic increase is going to happen in Africa. And if Africa continues to produce food with the technologies that it's using today, but it tries to do it for a much larger population, the impact on the environment will be huge. So there is a big problem of trying to transfer new technologies from the countries that have developed these technologies into the countries that can make the most use of them. Of course, with the correct social and economic approach. And these will be extremely useful to reduce inequalities and also to overcome an additional problem, which has to do with the fact that we do a lot of greenwashing, and that's typical of Europe and the European Union. And when the European Union makes its choices in the area of sustainability of the food system, it decides that they want to decrease the environmental impact of agriculture in Europe. That's fine, we all want that. But if the price to pay to reduce the environmental impact of agriculture in Europe is the fact that what we do not produce because we want to decrease environmental impact will be produced elsewhere. And if when it is produced elsewhere, it has a greater impact than when we produce it in Europe, the overall result will be that the environmental impact globally will increase. And additionally, in order to produce what we do not produce any longer, we will be decreasing the capital of natural resources of other countries that are extremely rich in natural resources, biodiversity, and so on and so forth, and we will not be compensating them for that. So it will be yet another way by which we exploit other countries for the benefit of our own economies without properly compensating them for that. So these are big global problems that we will try to tackle today and tomorrow. I hope that we will come out of these 2 days with a clearer understanding of what the problems are at all levels, scientific, economic, socially. We'll start with discussing how to communicate the importance of innovation and science in the food system. And I hope we will come out of these 2 days with some proposals. Since we have here our Minister for Research, I think a useful initiative that our region could try to launch is an initiative for labeling food. We have labels on the food that describe how many calories the food contains, how many of those come from protein, carbohydrates, fats. We should have a label that describes to the consumer what is the exact environmental impact of the food he's buying into, in terms of energy consumption, greenhouse gas emission, water consumption. It's a very complicated problem, but it would be a very interesting project that could lead the consumers to make more rational choices when it comes to food consumption and environmental sustainability. I think also we need to make the consumer understand that when they buy food, they're only paying the direct prices of food production. There is a whole set of indirect costs that nobody at the moment is paying. If the consumer had to pay for the direct plus the indirect costs, the prices of the food that we consume would be much higher. And right now, it's the planet that is paying for those costs and nobody else. And we have to try to change the situation and make sure that if we don't want to charge the consumer also for the indirect cost, we need to make sure that we decrease those indirect costs. In all of these, science and innovation can play a very fundamental role. There is no way out of the sustainability dilemma that we're facing in the food system, if not that we adopt scientific and technological innovations to try to reduce the environmental footprint while increasing productivity and improving the quality attributes of our foods. Some people think that there may be easy solutions out of these. Some people think that if we only reduce waste, that will be enough. Some other people think that we can avoid consumption of animal products. But the reality is that neither of these two solutions will be sufficient, nor neither of these two solutions will be easy to accept for the consumers. So it's a much more complex problem, which will need much more complex solutions. I'll stop here and I'll let Claudio continue with the introduction.
Well, the introduction from my side will be totally different because I'm going to try to address the other side of the coin or the dark side of the moon. Actually, what we are dealing with is not only a problem with the food production, but also with the food consumption. We have to realize that about 25% of the total global population is overweight, which means that 25% of the 8 billion of people, and this is true particularly in the low-income countries, which is even worrisome, even more worrisome, is consuming less calories than what they are taking in, which means that the amount of food we ingest every single day is much higher, or the amount of calories we are using. This is mainly due to one fact, that our adolescents, our children, our population is not doing any or less exercise, physical activities. And the physical activity is simply because we are too pressed by a lot of different things which has kept us busy from the very beginning of our day until the last moments before sleeping. We have internet, we have phone calls, we have WhatsApp, we have you name it. And this makes impossible to take something which in ancient times was usual. And our kids were used to go to the school by walking. Now there's a car bringing them and taking them from the school to other additional activities. We were used to play football. We are play whatever in the backyard. No way. So altogether, this makes possible to increase our weight. And if you look carefully, what is really worrisome is that 40% of the European children are overweight, which means that we have to pay attention to this. So the issue is why this dramatic picture is affecting the sustainability. Because we, of course, as well described by my previous speaker, we need not only to improve the production of food, we need to improve how the food is used. And we need to teach people how to reduce or how to balance the in and out caloric balances. This is true because we are also be submerged by nonsense ideas. I mean, if you look carefully in terms of food, now there is a long-standing campaign, say that wine is dangerous. The wine dangerous, and we need to put on the label that like in the cigarettes, that wine can do something bad to your family, to your health, which is totally correct. But the issue is how much wine you drink. There's a landmark study done in 1999, assessing for the first time in general population how much alcohol you are allowed to use per day without any problem for your health. And the amount of alcohol is 20 grams per day, which means half a liter of wine. And we have to realize that in our culture, wine was a source of calories. Because wine was a source of calorie when food was very scarce, and the big celebration during Christmas and Easter is because it was the only 2 days when you can eat as much as you want. And then wine, which was a cheap calories produced at home, can be used to sustain your work. And wine, remember, ethanol is 7 kilocalories per gram. So it's a lot of calories. So this is the issue. And the issue is why in this issue, liver is important. This is because why I'm here. And I'm here for 2 reasons. Number one, because liver is, in my opinion, the most important organ in the body. Not because I'm studying liver, but simply because historically speaking, when the aruspices were opening a sacrificial animal, the first thing they were looking at was liver. And second, because liver is plays a central role in so-called metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome is overweight, hypertension, and reduced expectancy of life. And why is it playing a central role? Because liver has the bad attitude to, engulf itself of fat, the so-called steatosis, the fatty liver. And fatty liver is not a liver problem. Fatty liver is a metabolic problem. And fatty liver needs to be recognized because fatty liver may start a long way towards cardiovascular disease, a tumor, and a heart disease. This is what we need to discuss, define, and prevent. Mind that a child overweight now has the possibility to get a cirrhosis in 20 years, 10 times higher than a lean adolescent. And if this is the case, it has been calculated that in 20 years, which means around 2040, the main indication for a liver transplantation was a metabolic liver disorder related to overweight now. So we need to invest time and efforts to prevent this. This prevent in terms of cost, in terms of sustainability of the health system, and in terms of sustainability of the world. So basically what we need to do is to understand that a fat liver, a liver engulfed of fat, is important to predict the future. And how can I assess the possibility to have a fat liver? Very simple. You just make an ultrasonography, which is very cheap, which is available all over the world, and then you get the information. It's something like a good friend of us is telling several times that a fat liver is like if you are driving a car in your dashboard, there's a red light, it means that something is wrong. Maybe the oil, maybe the engine, maybe whatever. But this is what the fat liver is telling us. Something is wrong and we need to do something. And what we have to do, forget about drugs. There is no drugs for this. Forget about false ideas. If you eat more vegetables, you increase. If you eat more artichokes, you improve your liver. If you drink less wine, you have to increase your expenditure in terms of calories. You need to walk. You need to walk. You need to exercise. You need to go back at the ancient times when everything was based on physical activity. This is what we must done, and we must combine this dark side of the moon with the bright side of the moon. Bright side of the moon is how to produce food, how to increase the productivity. The dark side of the moon is how to reduce the effects, the damaging effects of overweight and over eating. And mind that if you go to Africa, or if you go to Asia, or if you go to South America, you realize how large is the population overweight. Which means it's not a factor of income, is a factor of structure, mentality. And also mind that if the parents are obese, the possibility that the children are obese or overweight is 10 times higher. So we need to teach the population how to deal and how to select the most beneficial food, the most aggressive foods for the planet, but we also need to understand that we need to eat less and to walk more. I think liver is playing a role. This is why the foundation is cooperating in this important and really new project, which in my opinion may be a frontliner for the future of our society. Thank you very much.
Is this sustainable?
Hopefully. Thank you, Claudio. And we are done with the introduction. So we'll take a break. During the break, we'll have a group photo. Before that, are there questions either from the attendees or online?
Okay. Okay, I'll be at your disposal.
Okay.
My pleasure.
More than a question, I very much appreciated your talk. Just one thing, there is a
I thought both speeches were very interesting. Just one thing, there is a correlation between income and obesity or malnutrition. Unfortunately, it is reversed. It is the lower your income, the worse your nutritional status. And this is both in countries, so we see this a lot in Africa, and as you mentioned, in lower income communities in richer countries. So we see this a lot, for example, in the United States and in inner city communities and so forth. So it's even worse than what we were thinking, that the poorer people tend to have the worst nutritional outcomes.
Right, exactly.
Thank you.
Well, yes, I mean, this is exactly the point. I mean, I'll give an example. I mean, if you go in the Andes, where they actually are supposed to eat very, very marginal amount of calories, and they supposed to expend a lot of calories by walking at high altitude. And if you look around, I mean, you are impressed amount of obesity present. And this is what we need to address. Because, I mean, it's very easy when we are living in the Fifth Avenue to go to exercising, to eat a lot of vegetables. But, I mean, this is not the case. I mean, we need to address the real problem. And the real problem is to link together all the expertise we have around this table. This is why the idea of this institution is brilliant.
Just a comment. I think based on what Walter Sergo told us about the environmental impact of medical procedures, we should compute into the cost of the food system also all the medical treatments that are due to the overnutrition, for example, and then the impact would increase
huge.
Even more.
I have a comment for this, also a part of my question, because we forget that we need to pay attention to food culture as well, because a majority of people in the States who are obese, and also in Ireland, I was shocked how many of these people, they don't cook, they don't know how to cook. They, for them, it's simply okay to go to the supermarket and buy, so many times they don't have kitchen to cook, actually. So that's also something that we need to address.
Well, they have definitely a microwave oven, but the point is that what you buy already assembled is something full of preservatives, because need to last longer than a usual fresh food. But there's a culture. The culture is that you don't have time to spend. There is one.
Thank you. I'm Vittorio Pandelli, and President of the Italian Liver Foundation. So I would certainly not enter into anything of what already Professor Tiribelli said, because he did it much better than I can. But I think that Professor Morgante has recalled Professor Sergo's reference about the impact of medicine, and definitely this is a way to join the two sides of the moon that you were mentioning, and I think it's rather important. But my comments are more provocative. Unfortunately, I got the invitation to come here a little bit late, and I had already some commitments, so I won't be able to stay the whole time. But when you were referring, Professor Morgante, about technology and food and the way people accept or don't accept new technologies in food, in my provocation, I would like to raise also, I don't know if it will be raised throughout the workshop, the issue about the use of biotechnology in agriculture and the production of genetically modified food. And what is the impact of that kind of production for sustainability? Just to give an example, I'm not a pro-GMOs, but I have been working in this sector for a while. And the impact that has the production of GM food is rather important in positive terms as well. Just think about the amount of pesticides that are to be used to combat pests, which can be combated without the use of pesticides, which means also having no trucks diffusing those pesticides. There was a calculation made in 1996 showing that the amount of greenhouse gases that was released by the trucks using dispersing pesticides was equivalent to something like 50% of all the cars circulating in Italy. I think that these are all elements that need to be taken into account. GMOs are not the silver bullet, but they can have an impact, a positive impact as well, with all the due consideration about safety. Finally, the fact that in the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, there is not one development goal which is centered on the conservation of biodiversity. It is dispersed throughout these 17 goals, which is fine, but I think it's a huge limit for the whole success of Agenda 2030. Thank you. I'm sorry if I was a little bit long.
Yeah, thanks a lot for raising these two issues. I'll address the second one. Food production is one of the biggest contributors to the loss of biodiversity. And it's a very simple thing. I mean, the biggest component in terms of environmental impact of food production is land use change, which means that we take land, which is hosting a natural ecosystem, we convert it into agricultural land, which of course supports much lower levels of biodiversity, among other things. So it's definitely a very important aspect. In terms of genetic improvement, it's my area of research. So of course, I'm very convinced that it can give a big contribution. If we look at historic data, they tell us that, I mean, if we want to be very simple in terms of how you bring innovation into the agricultural production system, you can do it in three ways. By modifying genetically plants and animals, so genetic improvement of plants and animals, by changing agronomic practices, and third, through chemistry. If we look at what has been the biggest contributor, both in terms of increases in yield and decreases in environmental impact, it has been genetic improvement. Historically, it seems to be around 50% alone for genetic improvement. And in the last 20, 30 years, that percentage seems to have increased even more. So it's definitely a very important strategy to try to decrease the environmental impact of food production. There are very innovative genetic modification technologies, among which genome editing through CRISPR-Cas is perhaps the most promising. And during the workshop, we'll deal with those aspects. There will be a presentation by Pier Domenico Paratta, who will exactly touch upon that. The other big innovation in agriculture is the use of very sophisticated modeling and informatics to go towards what is called precision agriculture or digital agriculture. And there will be a contribution in the afternoon by Bruno Basso from the US, who will tell us what we can do by using those technologies. But of course, these are technologies that it's easy to envision being implemented in our food production system, but the real challenge will be to make those technologies available globally, because the biggest impact of those technologies will not be in Europe or in the US, it will be in those countries that will have, due to climate change, the biggest problems with food production, and that will see the biggest increases in population and food needs.
Which is Africa.
Which is Africa.
All right, thank you. I just wanted to add something. You already addressed some of the things I wanted to ask, but just to maybe drop this point for us now that in my home part of the world, it's so funny and interesting that even people in the villages, they live longer than the people in the city, because they eat better food. They eat raw food from the farm with a little or no processing and all of that that has gone through, you know, the food system in the city. So people in the villages, they live longer. They eat raw, good food, unprocessed food. And just talking about the health aspect of this talk. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, I agree. The point is that it's very difficult to compare the two situations. Because although the fact that in the farmers are probably eating much better than us, because they are eating raw and then much more health food, the life they are doing is totally different from the life we are doing in the city, in terms of stress, in terms of pollution, in terms of you name it. And I think that, I mean, at the end, you need to draw a line. And the draw a line is usually the farmers are living less than the people in the city. And this also because, particularly in the low middle income countries, because the medical facilities are not so easily available for the country. We are, I mean, at the foundation, we are studying different models. I mean, one of which is neonatal jaundice, for instance. You know, all of us are becoming jaundice upon birth, and this is good. But if the jaundice too much, maybe have a different. I mean, if you are getting jaundice here, you can go to Bordeaux. In no time, you can get assessment. But if you are jaundice in the middle of the Andes, that's totally different. So this is where we need to make things sustainable. We need to have a sort of a common level to make possible to all of us around the world to eat well, not to waste a lot of energies and environmental goods, and then have the possibility to live definitely better. Next question.
Okay, so if there are no other questions, we have a problem for a group that names itself quantitative, because the program says that at 10:30 we have a 30-minute break, but we reconvene at 11:15, which is 45 minutes later. So I don't know if the theory of relativity can help us here. You are physicists. So do we reconvene at 11:15? Okay, so we'll be back at 11:15. We have time for
a sustainable coffee
break and for a group photo. Okay.